whenever I'm in the post office or the supermarket or the barber shop, people always walk up and they say, "That's that guy. That's that man." They never say that's that minister. They don't even know that I'm a real preacher. And they say, "You be on, we wait for Monday, Dr. King's holiday, just to see you." And I say, I'm flattered. I say, "What about the mayor of Atlanta, the governor of Georgia? We have two senators in the pulpit of Georgia. And there's many Hollywood celebrities there on King Day." But they say, "But you have the spirit." And there are some of those people who are high and mighty. They say, "He's such a distraction. Oh my God, can he be calm? Can he be a little cool? He dressed nice. We know he intelligent, but those outbursts, we can't take it." But I want to tell you something. Over 80% of the people say, "Go ahead and praise him." And you know what? They don't want to have the service without my presence, because a lot of people are really ashamed to say amen for God. They're just not going to say it. But when I hear the tributes, and when I hear all the wonderful things about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., it makes me want to scream. And you can hear me on the radio and don't even see me, my voice.
Well, hello to everyone out there in YouTube land. I am Brother Rollins from the Videos of Christ YouTube channel. It is January 2024. And we want to take this time and opportunity to share with you all our reflections of the one and only Elder Cail Lester Merrell, Atlanta's famous very own, the happy preacher. On today, we have a very, very special guest, my dear friend and brother, Brother Alfred Jackson, who is a native of Atlanta. And Alfred and I had the opportunity no longer than about 15 years ago to start our journey in meeting and filming the documentary of The Happy Preacher. Brother Alfred, how you doing?
What's up? What's up?
All right, all righty. So, man, how can we really start this off, man? You know, what do you remember most about, you know, how we met and how we began the filming journey of this iconic documentary?
I just remember the first time just, you know, meeting him, because I really didn't know who he was, you know, until I came to Atlanta and really knew him, you know, knew of him, you know, because I used to watch the Dr. Martin Luther King, you know, service all the time, but I never knew about him. Mm-hmm. You know, I never did pay attention to, you know, him per se. So, I mean, just meeting him in person for the first time was a treat.
You know, I'm going to tell you something. When my parents and I moved to Atlanta, Georgia in January 1997, nearly almost, 26 years ago. Mm-hmm. No, my math is off. Forgive me, y'all. That was 27 years ago. I just remember, you know, living in North Carolina. I never knew that there was a Martin Luther King commemorative service going on in Atlanta. We just acknowledged the Martin Luther King, you know, holiday, national holiday. We were just off of school.
Right.
I just remember it was 1997, that Martin Luther King Monday. I watched the program for the very first time. I was about 13 years old, getting ready to turn 14. And watching the service, you know, seeing all the dignitaries and famous people. And there was this man in the congregation in the historic Ebenezer Baptist Church where, you know, Daddy King, his father-in-law pastored, and where Martin King, mm-hmm. brother pastored the church. And mind you, a lot of people, you know, you could get in and you could not get in,
right,
for that service. But mostly it was just for the dignitaries. And I said, "Who is this man?" Just, I could hear him hooping, hollering, screaming. I said, "Whoever is here, so excited to be in the house of the Lord for this program, you know." Yeah. And each year, I always saw this man. I'm like, who is that?
Mm-hmm.
My mom would, you know, would call me in the morning, you know, hey, you know, hey, look, she was at work. She said, hey, make sure you get up, don't miss the program. And she called me and she said, do you hear him? Do you see him? I said, yeah, there you go. We just didn't know what his name was, okay?
Mm-hmm. And
but every year, that was his way of saying hello to our household. So for our viewers, and to let you all know, before they were streaming, you know, that service has probably been broadcast in Atlanta probably no more than about 50 plus years.
Right.
The Martin Luther King program really started in January 15, 1969 by Martin Luther King's widow, late Coretta Scott.
Coretta Scott. Mm-hmm.
Who was a great leader in her own right. Alfred, let me ask you this. When was the first time you met the Happy Preacher?
The first time we met him was, I think when we took him to the beautiful restaurant, wasn't it?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What I do remember is this, you know, I was in college in the mid 2000s and just getting ready to finish school, graduate in 2005 of June. And mm-hmm. My sister, my older sister, she and I were just talking and she was just like, you know, hey, you know that nobody has ever interviewed the Happy Preacher since you graduating, you know, with your degree in media production. Why don't you interview the Happy Preacher? You know, it just went in one ear after the other. And it's always just stuck with me for about 2 or 3 years. And in, I want to say April 2006, I'll just give y'all some background of where my media journey began. It began at a church in Decatur, Georgia, right behind South Cab Mall. And that's where I met my media mentors, who was also a mentor to Alfred as well, too, Ron and Shayla Epps. And they trained me in media production in the church, you know, learn how to operate cameras, do technical direction of the camera shots. And so fast forward, you know, 2007 on the media team, and then, you know, February, I think it was Valentine's Day, that Sunday, that second Sunday, the pastor at the time, at that location, was preaching a sermon called Healing Human Hurts.
Mm-hmm.
And, it was Valentine's Day. And I was on the camera, and, you know, people were joining the church from left to right. And that's when I first saw Alfred and Alfred's first wife, Monica.
Yeah.
And Alfred was singing a song, and he sang a little verse and he handed the microphone off to Alfred.
Oh, and yeah, we tore that church up that day.
Yeah.
Oh, we had 100 people. We had 150 people that got saved.
Yeah, they joined that day. Because every time the church that we were at, you know, the church was growing in droves. We had about 50, 60-plus people join a Sunday. I'm talking about, I mean, it was just mind-blowing. And
yeah.
All I remember, this lady was shouting right behind Alfred, and she was trying to hold on to it. And then after service, we introduced ourselves. And from that time on, man, we have just been very, very dear friends. His first wife, Monica, mm-hmm. a true big sister and protector to me. And but going forward, you know, that year, getting to know one another. And
yeah,
I said, hey, you know, my sister encouraged me years ago to interview this preacher. And he's very well known. He gets into every political event,
right?
The event, and he has the pictures to prove it. I mean, anything that's going on, whether it be in Atlanta or anything around the world, Happy Preacher would be there,
right?
And, I just remember, man, also like talking with Alfred, talking with you, man, and just telling you, hey, look, you know, I need some help trying to get this film together. And sure enough, we kept talking about it for a good while. And but wasn't until the summer of 2008, I won't say July, contacted the Happy Preacher and, you know, to say, hey, you know, we'd like to take you out to eat at the beautiful restaurant on Cascade Road.
Yeah, buddy.
So now for all people that have never been to Atlanta or you've been to Atlanta, one of the top soul food places to go to is the beautiful restaurant.
You got to go to it. You got to get it. You got to get it.
Did you ever eat at the beautiful restaurant growing up in Atlanta?
What'd you say?
Did you ever eat at the beautiful restaurant growing up in Atlanta?
Oh, yeah. My dad took us there a bunch of different times. Because, mm-hmm. That was our neck of the woods, Ashby Street and, over by Morris Brown and Spelman. That was pretty much where we kind of grew up in that area. So we was nowhere from, Abernathy and Cascade. I mean, all that area, that was the area to be in, so.
Right. And, the thing about it is, backtrack. I'm gonna go back a little bit. My first time meeting the Happy Preacher officially was September 2005 at the Georgia World Congress Center in the National Baptist Convention.
Okay.
And he was sitting at this telephone booth and pretty much just to himself, had his bag of pictures. We'll talk about that a little bit. And I walked up to him. I said, "Hey, aren't you Elder Cail Merrell?" He was just dumbfounded, but he was like, "Don't nobody know me by my real name." But he said, "You know my real name." I said, "Yeah." I read about you, and I said, "You the guy I always see at the Martin Luther King program on TV." And he just started busting out laughing. I said, "Have a preacher, you have to understand this. That was your way of saying hello to our household." I said, "You be waving your hands and, yes, 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 woo, I said, "Man, I said, it just really just, I was like, man, he is so excited about Martin Luther King."
Yeah.
And then, we just began to talk a little more, and he gave me this, give y'all an example here. He gave me his telephone number on a long sheet.
Of paper,
Him and Judge Glenda Hatchett. And that was his, his business card. And sure enough, I always just say hello to him at many times. And I just always called him. But it wasn't until, like I said, we talked about, the beautiful restaurant. And Brother Jackson had the opportunity to pick him up. And we took him out. And we just really enjoyed his stories. Happy Preacher.
He had a lot of different stories. Yeah.
What's a story that stuck out to you when we met with him at the beautiful restaurant? Or just any story
that he? I think the one when because I really didn't know him, so I just wanted to know where his head was. I think I asked him about Barack Obama, I think, or some of the presidents that he's that he met. Mm-hmm. He had the pictures to prove it. Mm-hmm. He's like, "Oh, I met this person, or I met this preacher, or I met this senator, or this president, or this celebrity, James Brown or Michael Jackson or whoever the case may be." But he had the pictures to show you that, okay, I know this person, or I took a picture with this person. They know who I am. Mm-hmm.
Yes. And the biggest question was this, how was he able to get to all these places?
That's what I always wondered. The man didn't have no car.
Right.
He didn't travel by bus. Greyhound only went so far.
Right. If he traveled by Greyhound or he hits the ride with somebody.
I mean, either he just had great favor with God, mm-hmm. and was able to make it to these places and go to these places without somebody taking him. I mean, we just didn't know because we never really asked him.
Right.
I mean, because I just like, I'm not going to ask him that. He get there the way that he got there.
Yes.
So,
Yes. And the fun thing about it was, all those pictures that he took, from Whitney Houston.
Yeah.
Michelle Obama.
Usher, Chris Tucker, Lisa Left Eye. I mean, it's
DLC.
Look, when he said Usher,
I just encourage all our viewers out there to please take the time to go on our YouTube channel, your Brother Rollins Videos for Christ. And there, if you click the playlist tab, you'll see part one and part two of the film. But in the film, and about his life story, you're going to get a very, very more deep, personable touch. And you'll be able to get to know the happy preacher more about his life, number one.
Right.
You'll be able to better understand him, because a lot of us, we saw him shouting, dancing in church. He had his tambourine that he wiggled, that he brought with him. He had his little Bible, and he had his bags of pictures also. And he just had that special relationship and common touch with preachers and ministers. But of course, you all do know that he was a member and a licensed, ordained minister in the Church of God in Christ. Birth is his denomination. And he loved the Church of God in Christ. I mean, from 1968 of with meeting the presiding bishop, J.O. Patterson, who was the uncle of the late Bishop G.E. Patterson. After him was Bishop Lewis Henry Ford from Chicago. Then after him was Bishop Chandler David Owens, who was from Birmingham, but pastored in New Jersey and later moved, relocated to the Marietta, Georgia area, and became a presiding prelate of one of the jurisdictions there. And then, as the half preacher said, the great dynamo after Bishop Chandler Owens was
the late dynamo.
That's Gilbert Earl Patterson. P.O. Box 1, Memphis, Tennessee, 38101. Some of y'all might remember that from watching on TV. And then, you know, Bishop Charles Blake. And then after that, you know, after Bishop Blake was current presiding bishop, Bishop J. Drew Shear. And he loved the Church of God in Christ, number one. But I just want to just ask you, Alfred, when we picked him up and we started filming him, which was around March 2009. What do you remember most about getting things set up for that day?
We had, we had a lot of stuff we had to do. I mean, especially, you know, just getting the production stuff together, you know, because we had to do a lot of that production stuff before he came. I mean, which we had to go pick him up, but... it was mostly getting the production stuff ready, the cameras and the lighting and stuff together, and just getting all the his information and, you know, making sure he had, because he had to change outfits and all that stuff. So
a whole lot of outfits.
So he had, I think he brought three outfits. I was like, happy preacher, I don't think you need that many, but we're going to let you change into how many you want. So I think he ended up changing into three, right?
Yeah, about three.
Yeah, I think it was three. So, yeah, but I mean, we was cool with it, though.
Yeah. And one thing about him, his outfits, they were unique.
Yeah.
Colorful. And I think he did tell us, both of us, that I got clothes that's older than both of y'all.
Oh, yeah. And then he smiled.
Yeah. In the first portion of the film, and I want to encourage you all as viewers to watch it in its entirety, number one. But for some of our viewers, I want to offer the opportunity. If you have watched it in its entirety, I would like to do a live stream talk with you about your thoughts about the film. And if you were part of the Church of God in Christ, you saw him at church services, the convocations. Especially Church of God in Christ, I need y'all to holler at us so we can just have some great dialogue and just reflect on the life and the memory of the happy preacher. Because sad to say, you know, this is January. This marks 2 years of his passing. Of course, happy preacher, his transition was announced on Martin Luther King's birthday 2 years ago in 2022.
Right.
you know, and leading up to the Martin Luther King holiday. And I remember that morning, my mother and I were talking, and we were still under, you know, pandemic restriction guidelines. And what I definitely remember was talking to my mom, and I said, you know, Mom, are they gonna allow people into Ebenezer on Monday morning, especially like the happy preacher? She said, if they don't let the public in, the happy preacher gonna get in.
Right. He'll make his way in there.
Right. Because in 2021, there wasn't a lot of people inside of the sanctuary, but happy preacher made it in.
Yeah.
The graciousness of a minister, I'm going to keep his name quiet, but he know who he is. And, mind you, at the time, Dr. Christine King Ferris, her sister-in-law, Naomi Barber King, and Dr. Christine King's Ferris's daughter, Dr. Angela Watkins, were in the sanctuary. It was a few others, but it wasn't nobody inside of there. But head preacher was in the back, carrying on as he did. And matter of fact, one of my Facebook friends, Ole Tolbert, he actually was the one that kind of recorded and showed us that he made it inside of the sanctuary. So mother Facebook friend like Kimberly Bradford, you know, she was like, you see, is the happy preacher there? That was always the biggest thing, you know, when there was a service being streamed, is the happy preacher there?
Right.
Sure enough, he was there.
With the tambourine in hand.
Yep, and you hear his funny outbursts and everything. What else you would get into the film is you would get to know more about his childhood. You're going to hear stories about his love for Dr. King and the King family, his love for his great friendship with Pastor Shirley Caesar from Durham, North Carolina. He is going to share with you about, you know, because many people question, like, again, how does he get to these places? So you'll get an answer about that. But also, did you all know that the Happy Preacher was a great cook? Mm-hmm. What do you remember about his cooking, Alfred?
Oh, yeah. When he told us about the one time when he, whatever event or whatever he cooked for, he's like, you come to my table. He's like, you gonna know, you gonna know that I cooked it. Yeah, I didn't know he was in the field of cooking and stuff like that. I didn't know he did that for a living.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he sure did. For many years, Happy Preacher worked at the Grady Hospital.
Yeah, at the hospital. Yeah,
downtown Atlanta, and he was a food service worker in. And I'm not going to spoil the film for y'all on that, but he's going to share things about them. Just give me y'all just the introductory portions of categories we talked about. And you're going to learn who gave him his nickname, the Happy Preacher.
Yeah.
So when you watch the film, you come back to this video, I want you to type in the comment section the name of the person that gave him his nickname. And where did he get the nickname back? The city and state and the year. Okay. Mm-hmm.
I think it's a lot of people if they haven't really seen the Happy Preacher, mm-hmm. you know, per se on TV or, you know, on the Martin Luther King celebration day, this is going to let you know exactly who he is. I mean, because we captured a lot of good topics of, you know, of him and his family and who he is and where he's from, how he was raised. And I mean, he told it all. We asked it. And we asked him. He told us. Mm-hmm. So we had some edits and stuff. That was funny.
And ladies and gentlemen, you're going to get some bloopers. You have to see him on Facebook. I don't know if we can put it out there on YouTube. You know, it might be a little extreme.
Oh yeah, I forgot about those ones that we did in the car.
Yes.
When we picked him up that day, and when we were talking about Obama, and you know, this was during the election year.
Yeah.
With Obama, and we was just discussing stuff, and mm-hmm.
even off camera, you know, you guys, Again, you know, he knew how to lock you in with his stories. And it was to the point, it wasn't boring, it was engaging. It was just like, you know, tell us more. Cause, you know, we, Alfred and I were sitting at the feet of a man of wisdom, mm-hmm. a man that really loved God.
Oh, yeah.
But also, you know, Heparici did have some major challenges in his life, and he was very vulnerable and very honest about it, about some things that he did experience in his life, from his very close relationship with his grandmother and his mother. And you're going to just hear the great love he just had for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I don't think it was just because he just wanted to just take a picture with him that, you know, here he was, you know, born and raised in South Georgia.
Yeah.
And he's seeing someone, pretty much, I say, a prophet that was sent to the earth by God, that was created to bring change to the world. And that just inspired him. And just, he was determined to not stay in South Georgia all his life and get to Atlanta, Georgia. And that preacher did arrive in Atlanta in April of 1967. And from that time on, you're going to find out his love for Coretta Scott King, his love for her children. He definitely loved Dr. Willie Christine King Ferris.
Yeah.
Her whole entire family as well. And what I truly, my favorite story from part one of this was just finding out who gave him his nickname again, you know? Mm-hmm. That was one of the biggest highlights. And sitting down with him. Because one thing about it, when you sat down with the Happy Preacher, you know, he would conversate with you. He loved talking about Jesus. But you were going to sit there and look at all them 50 million pictures. And just be so amazed, you know.
He gave me a stack of them, too.
A whole stack, man. Like
every time we saw him, he would bring us even more. Mm-hmm. And I was like, Heaven Preacher, we can't add all these pictures. I was like, we're gonna have to, you know, kind of thumb through them and, mm-hmm. you know, pick, you know, what's gonna be the most important that's gonna go with whatever, you know, we were displaying or talking about at, you know, on the screen. So, yeah. I mean, but they still all came in handy. We didn't use them all, but mm-hmm. I mean, I think we got a copy of most of them.
Most of them. We know, if, you know, I've shared them out there on Facebook as well, too, so you'll be able to see a lot of them. And I mean, every preacher you could possibly think of, music group, Oprah, presidents.
Yeah, celebrities.
Celebrities.
Athletes. I mean, he pretty much knew a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think my favorite photo was with him and Obama.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think when I first saw that, I was like, wow. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay. I was like, this man legit. I was like, he got receipts.
Right. But you know,
what was your favorite part as just you know, us, you know, putting the video and putting everything together? What was your fondest moments? What was your you know, greatest moments?
I think the greatest moment was I remember picking him up because we filmed him in March 2009 and then May of 2009.
Mm-hmm.
I just remember when we finally finished the film, because there were long nights, y'all, where me and Alfred were working on the computer back and forth. His home in McDonough, and you know, staying up to the wee hours of the morning, just working on it, and you know, calling him up. Mm-hmm. This time I picked him up, and then you know, we brought him to y'all's home, and
yeah.
He was just sitting on the couch, just crying his eyes out. I felt like we had, you know, pretty much that to me, that's when I knew we kind of hit a home run that day. That's my the greatest moment out of this of filming this project. And I'm just thankful, man, because you know, outside of, you know, us knowing him, you know, saying crazy things in the church, outbursts, and, you know, being the loudest in the room.
Yeah.
And you know, to me it was comedy. To some,
oh yeah, movie. I mean, a lot of people thought it was funny.
Yeah,
you know, thought it was more of a put on. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I get what they were saying, but I mean, he just loved God. He was very charismatic, mm-hmm. and very, you know, outspoken. He wasn't gonna let nobody shut him up.
No. he wasn't gonna let no rock cry.
No. No, sir. Not at all.
But a special treat later on. We're gonna share this online. The question for you all is out there. If you put it in the comment section, say yes or no. Has anybody ever heard the happy preacher preach?
Yeah, he got a couple of clips on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. He does.
Yeah.
We were able to capture a special homily or sermonette moment.
Sermonette, yeah.
Yeah. From him. And it was just great to just hear him just, you know, bring forth God's word. Of course, he preached on one of them from Acts 2, mm-hmm. about receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah,
filled with the Holy Ghost, and but that was important to him, especially within, you know, the denomination he was part of with the Church of God in Christ, being filled with the Holy Ghost. And what I love most about what he shared was he was talking about people are would always talk about, you know, will this guy just be calm?
Yeah, will he just be quiet? Won't he sit down? And yeah. That's
so nice. But he said 80% of people told him, go ahead and praise him anyhow. Yeah, and he shares some other stories too. I believe he is the cousin to Damon Wilson, you know, the mm-hmm. man that played Lamont from Sanford and Son.
Sanford and Son, yeah.
Now, all y'all out there on YouTube, now, I just saw a recent interview with Damon Wilson, being interviewed by the Comedy Hype, talking about his career as an actor and also his calling to the ministry after leaving Hollywood. Now, the interviewer that interviewed him, let's just say he got a good lesson on how not to be prepared for that interview. And like I said, to that brother, you know, it's just like, wow.
Yeah.
Like,
and it showed.
My prayer is that Damon Wilson could see this film as well too. And Pastor Shirley Caesar, you know, but I think it's going to work out. We'll be able to get both of them. This film.
Oh yeah. I think we'll be able to get, you know, a lot of different people to come in and just, and talk about the film. And then, you know, So, I mean, we'll be coming on doing other things on here as well. Just, you know, talking about current events and just bringing people on, just having discussions about, you know, the word and, you know, what's going on in the church world. No gossiping type stuff, but, you know, just, you know, we're going to talk about what's going on, but none of that gossip stuff, all that TDJ mess going on and all that. No, we don't want to talk about all that.
right. And the thing about it is, what I appreciate is when the happy preacher really just for you all just to understand this, outside of what you all may have seen online or in person, you're gonna get a personable touch.
Yeah.
A better understanding of him, because most of the time we can define a person by what we see, but behind it, we just don't know what they've been through, what they have experienced. And that was the main goal of the film. I see, you know, everybody just see him as the shaking the tambourine and dancing and running around the church. I said, you know, they need to get to know him in a better way.
Yeah.
In a more respectable way.
And not just that. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
And we did our part as, working on this project to not ask anything that was degradable or disrespectful.
Right.
And have preacher understood that before he left here, that's what he appreciated about us, because, you know, people will do things, you know, out of spite or anything or to be messy, you know. Trust me, when y'all watch it, it's like, wow, I understand him better now.
It's yeah.
But be on the lookout, you know. We're going to talk with some preachers. We're just going to talk with some everyday viewers. You know, I want to talk to some of my viewers here on Videos for Christ YouTube channel. I'm going to do about 3 or 4 Church of God in Christ members that are new to Have Preacher, but also watch the film. But I'm going to tell y'all something going forward. In order for us to have a discussion with you, for you to participate as a guest, you have to watch the film in its entirety, both parts. And before we go live, you will be quizzed on some questions about the film. All right?
Right.
I have to make that
known. You got to do your homework.
You got to do some homework and everything. Yeah. So you know, that's your assignment. You got to watch the film in its entirety. And
make sure you go watch it, Ricky.
Dr. Ricky Flipper, he's already watched it, because
I know. I was just being funny. Yeah, because we watched it at his house, remember?
Right.
Yeah.
It was the day before Thanksgiving, man. And my Atlanta pastor, Dr. William Flippin, Greater Pine Grove Baptist Church, one of the gracious, one of the most awesome churches there in Atlanta.
Shout out.
Yeah, 1879 Glenwood Avenue. I think they start church at 9 a.m. right now, so you know you will be blessed at that church. But they had a very, very close and dear relationship with the Happy Preacher as well too. Mm-hmm. There's so many other pastors around the United States of America, but you know, a lot of them in Atlanta.
Especially Jasper Williams. We got to get him.
Mm-hmm. Oh yes, most definitely. Mm-hmm. Jasper Williams. I think Jonathan Carter.
Yeah.
I can't think of a Church of God in Christ pastor there in Georgia, but wait a minute. Chris Tucker's pastor, Bishop Hogan.
Hogan. Mm-hmm.
And his mom, Mother Mary Tucker, because she's over the Department of Women.
Okay.
You know, she's a part of the Church of God in Christ. I do apologize, but I know she might be the state supervisor, one of the leaders of the women's department as well, too.
Oh, okay.
So Church of God in Christ, y'all help me, correct me. I do apologize if I misread that as well. But yes, look, that would be awesome to get Chris Tucker, man.
That would be real nice.
Get 5 minutes of him. Yeah. But you know what?
I believe he'll give us about 30. I believe he'll give us 15.
Mm-hmm. Yep. But going back to January 15, 2022, when we learned of Cap Preacher's transition, I learned about it from a film director that reached out to me to confirm with me that he had transitioned. But on the day of that transition, and we learned of his transition in Toledo, Ohio, Happer Preacher's brother, Benny Merrell, was being buried that day.
Right.
Yep. And it was just, you know, like they say, we just don't know when the Lord shall call us home. And
exactly.
And because even that day, I was watching a funeral that day. You know, I talked to my mother once again, and I was watching the funeral. And then that's when the news just came about. And, you know.
Yeah. And Lewis texts me, and I was like, oh, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, I think even at his second funeral, to have Chris Tucker just to speak and just share great things about him, that was
That was nice.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And, of course, his famous sayings, Happy Preacher, say that. and he wiggled his tambourine.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to, he would say, "Oh God, oh God, oh God,
oh God."
And but you know, the biggest question was this. Not biggest question. You're going to learn also about how he was able to get to everywhere. He's going to explain from his own perspective how he's able to get to all those great events.
Yeah, how he was able to get around.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And, you know, but just to hear the personal side outside of what we experienced him was just very, very great, awesome. Everything.
Yeah.
I do want to ask this question. Got to go to my little notes here. Matter of fact, I'm going to choose one of your questions, Alfred.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
All right. What did the Happy Preacher do to just make you say, wow?
Yeah.
What was a wow moment from the Happy Preacher?
I think the time he came over our house and we, you know, we fed him. And, you know, we would, I guess we were trying to get some things from him. And he was telling Monica, you know, my late wife, he was telling her, "You like, y'all are persistent. Y'all are, y'all," you know, because we were trying to get things done. You know, we wanted to get things done in a rapid, you know, time, and, you know, so that we can finish this project up. And he was just like, y'all are on it. And I was just like, yeah, we own it. But I just liked the way that he acknowledged, you know, what we were doing. And he, you know, he recognized our poise, you know, our quickness and our honesty and our kindness on what we were doing, you know, getting the video prepared and stuff like that. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
he just said a lot of things that was like, okay, wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, another wow moment for me was, have to be, I just remember, you know, to let y'all know this. Okay, we finished filming in May of 2009. You know, we were editing, you know, 3-4 months straight. Anywhere where the Happy Preacher was, we was there. Mm-hmm. It was always church. And at the time, you know, I know Alfred and Monica and I, we were in transitions from church. And but somehow, some way, I ended up joining Greater Piney Grove, but I didn't join until Easter 2010. And I just remember just having the support of the Flipping family. Number one, like I said, we showed the Happy Preacher the film first,
right?
But the next group of people that we showed it to. It was the day before,
yeah,
home of Dr. William and Mrs. Flipper, and the house was full of people. I'm talking about people from Beulah Missionary mm-hmm. Baptist Church, Greater Piney Grove, and some other, you know, Atlanta people. And you know, Reverend Flipper said, "Hey, bring that DVD over here, Rollins." he said, "We're gonna go down to the theater, we're gonna watch it." And everybody watching it, his whole entirety, and you know, everybody was just. It was just locked in. You could hear a peep, but there was some laughs as well too. They were
they enjoyed it. They really did enjoy it.
Yeah, and you know, y'all never know, man. I hope we can possibly, you know, share this at a big film event or something in Atlanta at a church. I think I got a church. I want to show it at, but definitely. Atlanta preachers and pastors, those that I know that were very close to Happy Preacher. Number one, Pastor Timothy McDonald from First Iconium Baptist Church. Judge Penny Reynolds, her husband, Reverend Edward Reynolds, pastors the church in College Park, Georgia. I think Bishop Norman Hopper, he's one of the bishops over there. Excuse me, of the jurisdiction in Georgia. As a matter of fact, he pastors the church over there right by South DeKalb Mall. and some other Church God in Christ people. So, you know, I'm going to reach Church God in Christ, and they're going to be reaching out to you all for your help within that. I do know that that preacher had a very close person in Church God in Christ, a church preaching elder by the name of Elder Jeremy Henry.
Mm-hmm.
Very close with him. And but, oh, yeah, funeral directors. I'm issuing this call to you all. If the happy preacher was at a funeral service that you directed or worked, please contact us. Contact me. Number one, the first funeral home I'm going to interview is Willie A. Watkins. Legendary funeral director in the South, Mr. Willie A. Watkins and his brothers.
Mm-hmm.
I was in Columbia, South Carolina for a funeral, and I ran into his to his brothers and his nephew, and they all run some of the family funeral homes. And the nephew has a funeral home in Central South Georgia as well too. So,
right,
forward to interviewing them with just getting their interview portion as well too, because I know they have tons of stories. Matter of fact, Alfred, tell everybody about the time you and I walked into Willie Watkins' funeral home. What do you remember about that?
Well, well, I mean, I you know, I don't really like funeral homes, but you know, we went in that day. So we went in, and I who was the lady at the desk? Monica, what was that lady's name?
Miss Jackson.
Miss Jackson, yeah. Yeah, Miss Jackson met us at the door, and we told her we need to see brother Watkins, and he met us, and we took us in the room back there, and we put the video on for him, and he's like, "Oh yeah, that's gonna be a good film right there."
And you were also funny.
So we weren't able to, you know, really let him see the whole thing. He kind of saw a little snippet because they got kind of busy, and I was like,
really
"Okay, we're gonna." Yeah, they got really busy. It was just nobody was there at first, and then they got really busy, so we couldn't interrupt, you know, them doing their, you know,
Alfred
their duties.
Alfred and I, we were, I'm talking about, we were putting the footwork. We went to Willie A. Watkins' funeral home. We went to Donald mm-hmm. Trump Mortuary in Decatur.
Yeah.
Especially to the funeral home that, you know, I mean, I don't think there was not a black funeral home in the Atlanta metropolitan area that did not know him.
Right.
I just remember, you know, we put in the footwork, because even at Willie Watkins' funeral home, at first, Mr. Watkins was at the desk, and then Ms. Jackson came in. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Because we didn't think that, you know, like, okay, you know.
Yeah, we didn't think he was going to, you know, be right there when we came in the front door.
Yeah, because he has multiple locations in LA.
Right, right.
And, of course, you know, me and Alfred were laughing because he was just getting on Ms. Jackson's nerves. Ms. Jackson! he told us, he said, "Oh, have preaching. Yeah, he slick.
And, yeah, he did.
And then we did talk to another funeral director, because he kind of gave us, you know, his fond memories of the happy preacher. This, like I said, this is back in 2009, y'all.
Yeah.
And you know what? I think they might still have a copy, because see, back in those days, we were.
Yeah, I think we gave them a copy, I think.
Yeah, we were doing DVD copies at the time.
Yeah,
y'all.
I think we gave them a copy of it, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if any of y'all have.
They don't tell them what that copy is.
Back again. So, what's your last comment or reflection just of the happy preacher, just in general?
I just want to say that, I mean, I had so much fun, you know, creating this, you know, documentary for him, and I learned a lot of stuff about him, because I just didn't know who he was. I didn't pay attention to him, you know, all the years that I watched Martin Luther King's service. I never mm-hmm. paid attention to him. Mm-hmm. I mean, they may have showed him, but I just didn't think about it, you know, because my mind was on the, you know, the service. So, but I mean, I really enjoyed, you know, documenting him, you know, before the Lord took him home, you know, taking him home. So, I mean, I wish we could have, you know, got a part two, you know, of him, you know, like today, I think it would have been, you know, another great, you know, documentary or just interview, you know, kind of like what we're doing now. Just, I mean, I don't know how, you know, how we could have did it with him, because, you know, he really wasn't tech savvy. And, you know, I don't even think he had a cell phone.
No. That preacher had a home phone. And that was it.
I don't even think he had a cell phone, so, but I mean, I enjoyed it, and, you know, it was a great experience. It was a learning experience. I mean, because we both were already doing editing and stuff and doing video work, so it was great to, you know, kind of do that and kind of do something different than just filming churches and, you know, editing their service and the preachers and stuff like that. So that was fun for me. It was nice.
Mm-hmm. I mean, my last thing would be is, what I enjoy most about it is just hearing more of his life stories. You know, I mean,
yeah,
he was the type of person that you could just sit down with and listen to all day long. Because there's many people in life that will, you know, will talk so much, they ain't talking about nothing. But he had a lot to talk about. But it was wisdom. It was you know, it was loving. It was it just brought in just a great atmosphere of unity in the whole just air, you know.
Yeah.
But just to he really showed us how he was so dedicated to God and why he loved to give God praise in his own way.
Oh yeah.
The thing about it is what I took most from it was, you know, because I've taken time just to look back at the first time we recorded it, and also the because even the time is during the time of his passing, you know, I just went in and just reworked some things and cleaned some things up, and then because like I said, for a while I thought I didn't have any of the pictures that he shared with us, but just look back at all those pictures, I'm like, man, this dude had a picture with Halle Berry and TLC and Whitney Houston and Shirley Caesar, you know, tons of Shirley Caesar and Bishop Charles Blake and Chris Tucker and Judge Hatchett.
Yeah,
you know, and these were people that he really was engaged with, you know, and that he did know. And, you know, a lot of people that he had opportunities just to take pictures with, you know, Hap Richard was even at the Grammy Awards and the Emmy Awards.
Right.
The Stella Awards, you know, like, how did he get tickets to go that, you know, go to those shows, man? But he just,
did he really tell us how he got stuff? Oh no! Remember, he told us about the presidential dinner he went to. Remember,
mm-hmm. He sat down with four presidents.
And he's like, I sat down with four presidents. I'm like, mm-hmm. They gave you tickets to that? I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Now that was a wow moment.
Yeah.
That was a wow moment. I was like, wow.
But he said that,
but I didn't mean to cut you off, but I think it was like, he said they were like, what, $200 a plate or,
mm-hmm.
or something like that, $200 a ticket. I was like, oh, wow.
Yeah, he got in free.
Got in for free.
He said George Bush, a junior, with George Daddy. W. Bush.
Dad. He said daddy.
Yeah. And who were the two? Clinton?
And Carter.
Carter, yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's what he said. He had receipts for it, so it was all true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I can only but imagine, you know, more pictures that we did not see that he had with other
right.
people.
I'm pretty sure he had plenty because he carried them around. So, mm-hmm. I mean, that was just probably the small amount that he had.
Yeah.
I mean, that he could bring along with him because he carried so many of those bags around. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah. And the thing about it was, I have a preacher, you know, we saw personal struggles and that's why I just, you know, I got a better understanding as to, you know, what was going on with him personally. And because you know, some did say, you know, hey, he as they say, he was a card, honey, you know, a card, you know.
Right.
And what I genuinely liked that the way he loved sharing, what I liked about him, what he shared with us was how he just, how can I put it? He just to me, he had a deep relationship with the Lord, like anybody should.
Yeah.
Because if he was with you, he was with you. That's what it was. He was with you. And, you know, like I said, my last moment would be is, he would show up to all those events.
And yeah.
Be there all day, be there from the beginning all the way to the end. And somebody would recognize him from the pulpit or, you know, or at an event, you know.
And he would go crazy.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
But the one time that we saw him, you know, get somewhere but get turned away was Whitney Houston's funeral.
No, Bobby Christina. He got right. into Whitney Houston's funeral.
Right, he should be.
But Bobby Christina, security wasn't playing with him on that time.
Yeah, they showed him going out in the news, showed him going down the street waving at the camera.
Yeah, all the way in Alpharetta, Georgia, and that's the end of the line.
Now, I was like, oh, heaven preacher tried to get in there. I said, well, that's all right. He'll get in the next one.
For our viewers, when Barack Obama was elected the president of the United States and the inauguration, came about in January 2009, heaven preacher received tickets for the inauguration by the honorable late John Lewis.
Mm-hmm.
That preacher told us off camera, you know, just, hey, look, you know, the tickets that he gave him, he said, okay, well, this section is not close enough. But somehow, some way, half a preacher, no matter
made
where
he made it to the stage.
Yeah, he made it up to this top stage. And guess what, y'all? We have the pictures to prove it.
Yeah, he took pictures with everybody.
Chris Tucker, gospel radio DJ, Rodell Lewis.
Yeah,
mother. His
he took. Didn't he take one with Aretha?
No, mm-mm. No.
I'm sure, who else he?
Because
I think P Diddy. I think P Diddy or somebody was there.
He said Puff Daddy was there, but he didn't take a picture with him. But I'm quite sure he probably had one. But to let you guys know that, you know, at the time of Happy Preacher's transition, a lot of his material, from my understanding, was thrown away. But we're going to do some more research to find out if that's true or not. But that's what was being right. said at the time of his transition. Because, you know, with technology now versus how it was back then, that preacher had the old school, you know, the camera, he had to wind up.
Yeah.
he didn't have like a digital camera and all that kind of stuff. So,
mm-hmm. Well, not the Polaroid, but the, you know, the old school. Kind of the kind you had to get developed, yeah.
With the negatives.
Negatives, yeah.
And
you had to go to the dark room.
I can say a real funny moment, you know, as the world was on restrictions, you know, he did not get a chance, opportunity to attend John Lewis's funeral or C.T. Vivian's funeral because of the high security.
Right.
But because the streets were blocked off around Ebenezer Baptist Church on Auburn Avenue. And a dear friend of mine who worked with the Park Service told me the story about how, you know, the Park Service had almost arrested him. But somehow, some way, though he did not get inside of the church, he got up to the front door of Ebenezer talking with the Willie Watkins Funeral Home staff members and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They would not let him inside of the church at all because of, you know, security of presidents and stuff. So I said, man, and I told the
park. He got close.
He got close, yeah. I'm like, he got past y'all. You know, I know y'all had stuff blocked off, but
Yeah, he got close. He almost got in the door.
Yeah, that wasn't stopping him at all and everything, you know. And that was just very interesting. That was a wild aha moment. Like, whoa, like you know, like he is unstoppable.
But I hope everybody enjoyed the documentary if you haven't seen it. It's a nice little documentary of, you know, who he is, and you'll get a lot of good laughs, and you'll really know who he is if you haven't, you know, seen him on TV before or whatever, you know, if you're from another state or country or whatever. I mean, it's a lot of people that really want to know who is that guy. He gonna tell you.
Right.
He gonna tell you.
Some of my friends in North Carolina, like, you know, I've seen him before, but like, who is he? Like, what
right.
What so let's say he's
right.
They call him the happy preacher. He said, yeah. Oh, do all that praising and shouting. That's yeah, dancing. He knew how to respond to the preachers and gospel mm-hmm. songs that were being sung and everything. So yeah. But you know what though, I'm thankful to God. I'm thankful to my older sister Kiyomi for inspiring me to really get the film created and done. I'm thankful to you, Alfred, for joining me in creating this iconic film, because I could just think, like, you know, like, man, I really would have regretted not doing this.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
that's I'm glad we got together and did it. I mean, it was meant for you and I to do it. So, I mean, I'm glad we shot that film and shot that documentary and had those crazy moments with the happy preacher, mm-hmm. the good and the bad.
Yeah, the good and the bad. And there were some nights, you know, happy preacher, you know, he had his moments. I'm like, okay, happy preacher, we're going to talk to you tomorrow. And
uh-huh.
You know, all the traveling back and forth, getting pictures, getting documents yeah. and getting things, yeah. and, you know, He did want us at the time. We didn't get a chance to do it. He wanted us to film him at the King Center, just to promote the film and everything. But I'm glad
we didn't get a chance to do it, did we?
No, but you know, that's why we're thankful for YouTube and TikTok and Facebook to allow us to share this awesome work. And we want you all, as you all watch the film, share it with somebody. So that they can just get a chance to know him more. And like I said, you guys are going to really see the very tender and serious side of him as a person. And as you all get to know more about him and his love for God and his love for just, for like I said, again, the King family and just his love for the world, period. And many people online have said this, and I agree with this statement too, like, you know, even this past Monday, watching the Martin Luther King commemorative service, it's just, I ain't gonna lie. I was waiting to hear his voice, but reality sinked in again that, you know.
Yeah, he was not there. Yeah.
He's not with us anymore, but with us in spirit. And even last year, you know, with him. Not last year, but, you know, 2 years ago, you know, to hear that thrilling tribute from Dr. Bernice King and how she shared with us how much that preacher meant to her and her whole entire family was just, you know, it was bittersweet because, like, you know, he left this world on his MLK's official birthday, and then here come Martin Luther King Monday.
Right.
Yeah. But he, like, as he said in the film, I was an integral part in
yeah.
the creation of the King Day celebration when it started in 1969.
Yeah. He was
15. Yeah, sure is.
Yeah.
But we're gonna go ahead and sign off. Thank you all. We'd like for you all to like, comment, and subscribe to the Videos of Christ YouTube channel. Once again, don't forget to watch the Happy Preacher Life Story documentary. That is listed, located under the playlist section. And definitely let us know what you think about it. And just be ready for the preachers, the Morehouse preachers, Church God in Christ, elders and pastors and ministers of the gospel and Church Christ, like I said, those members of the church and, and some of the viewers. I'm going to be contacting you all that watch the film and, like I said, going through the quizzing, the testing out process, and some more live streams about this each week. And you all have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful day. And Happy New Year to all you all. God bless.
See you all later. God bless.
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.